Thank you for the kind introduction, Bonnie, and thank you, Ken, for the opportunity to give this lecture and be part of this lecture series. So I've been really blown away by the innovation and the research that's going on at IHMC, and also the outreach programs, including such programs like the Summer Robotics Program and this lecture series. And it's really an honor to be here today to talk about a topic that I'm very passionate about, which includes metabolic therapy research. And first, I'd like to acknowledge the funding agency that has led to the development of these metabolic therapies, and that's the Office of Navy Research. The Office of Navy Research has been funding me now for 9 years, and the main application of the metabolic therapy that I'll be talking about is for central nervous system oxygen toxicity, or CNS oxygen toxicity seizures. And these are experienced in Navy SEAL divers who use a special closed circuit rebreathing apparatus. So the research that we did, the research that we did to develop a therapy for CNS oxygen toxicity led to the development of metabolic therapies, diets, and nutritional supplementation that have applications for a broad range of neurological disorders, including Alzheimer's disease, and we think Parkinson's disease, and traumatic brain injury. And they also have potential application for a variety of metabolic disorders, including type 2 diabetes and glucose transporter disorders. And the main application that I want to focus on tonight, and that I think I want to focus most of my effort on, the second half of the talk, is cancer. And so just to let you know that oxygen toxicity seizures result from breathing oxygen at a concentration above 2.5 atmospheres. So we're at 1 atmosphere now, and 2.5 atmospheres would be about 50 feet of seawater. And hyperbaric oxygen therapy, a limitation of the therapeutic potential of oxygen therapy, is CNS oxygen toxicity seizures. Hyperbaric oxygen therapy is used for a number of applications, up to 13 FDA-approved applications, including a decompression sickness, carbon monoxide poisoning, and also ischemic wounds. So as it relates to diving, so I mentioned that Navy SEAL divers, they use a closed circuit rebreather, which is breathing 100% oxygen. So oxygen toxicity is a limitation to their diving because at just 50 feet of seawater, let me get the pointer here, at just 50 feet of seawater, the potential for oxygen toxicity exists in just within 10 minutes. So as you can imagine, this is a severe limitation of their dive operations. And having a seizure underwater can be fatal. So the question that our lab is focused on, and my early work as a postdoctoral fellow, focused on understanding the molecular and the cellular mechanisms of CNS oxygen toxicity. We really don't know why these seizures occur, and we don't have any method to predict them. They occur relatively with no warning. So we asked the question, why do these seizures occur, and how can we prevent them? To understand fundamentally what oxygen seizures are, we use a variety of methods in the lab. And these include atomic force microscopy, fluorescence microscopy, laser scanning confocal microscopy, electrophysiology, and radio telemetry. What we've done in our laboratory is that we've adapted these techniques for use at hyperbaric pressures. So here's an example of a system that we've developed that is essentially in fluorescence microscope, confocal microscopy, and also atomic force microscopy. And with this technology, we're able to essentially dive a preparation. It could be cells, it could be tissues, and in other equipment, we can do animal studies and rodent models. And with this equipment and with atomic force microscopy, this allows us to understand how oxygen at graded levels of pressure cause changes in the cell membrane and also the proteins embedded in those membranes. And we can also, using scanning confocal microscopy, look at the function of the mitochondria. So the mitochondria of the cells are part of the energy system. So they are like the batteries of the cells. They supply the cells with energy. And we think that excess amounts of oxygen contribute to the formation of reactive oxygen species, also known as free radicals. Now, these free radicals can damage the lipids, the proteins within the membrane, and they disrupt the function of the membrane, which is a big regulator of the cell activity. And what we know, jumping from the level of the membrane and the mitochondria, what we know is that an increased amount of pressure, and we do these studies in rodent models, can lead to a seizure relatively quickly. So about 5 atmospheres of oxygen can produce a seizure in our rodent model within about 10 minutes. So 5 atmospheres of oxygen is 132 feet of seawater. So what we can do is, in our seizure studies, we can instrument the animal to measure EEG activity and physiological activity within the body, including heart rate and respiration. And this allows us to screen a variety of agents, and some of them I'll be talking about today, to determine, to increase the resistance, the physiological resistance to this high-pressure oxygen. So there's a variety of strategies that that have been tried to mitigate oxygen toxicity seizures. And of course, you know, the first one would be to dive within your exposure limits. But that's not always an option if you're doing an operation or undergoing a mission where the situation requires you to dive deeper or to stay down for a longer period of time. So it's really... A lot of guys who use rebreathers are faced with situations where they have to push the limits of their rebreathers. Antioxidants have been a strategy that the Office of Navy Research have looked into, and they have been largely ineffective. So in vitro models in a cell culture dish or tissues, antioxidants tend to protect cells against high levels of oxygen, which proportionally produce a higher level of reactive oxygen species. But in animal models, they tend not to work. And in divers, too, they're largely ineffective. Another option to prevent oxygen toxicity seizures is the use of anti-epileptic drugs, anti-seizure drugs. The problem with using anti-seizure drugs, as you may know, there's a lot of side effects associated with their use. And also, the levels needed to prevent oxygen toxicity are so high that it would create side effects that would impair the Navy SEAL divers. So investigating the potential mechanisms to prevent oxygen toxicity, I came across a body of literature that demonstrated that starvation ketosis, that fasting rodents for 24 to 36 hours produced a remarkable increase in the resistance to oxygen toxicity seizures. And it was above and beyond anything that I saw in the literature, above most anti-epileptic drugs. So this was something that was relatively straightforward and highly effective in most animal models tested. So there was a delay, and up to 250% delay in seizures with 36 hours of fasting. So the question I had, and really became motivated to understand, was how does starvation change brain energy metabolism? So we know from early reports, and this is from a 1922 from the paper, it indicated that fasting was a cure for epilepsy. And literature that goes back, scripture, and even 400 BC, during the time of Hippocrates, it was written that fasting could be a cure for seizures. So no one has really contributed more to understanding fuel metabolism in the brain then George Cahill, the late George Cahill. And I had the opportunity to talk to him before he passed in 2010. But he has really been a pioneer in these studies to fully understand how brain metabolism changes in the face of starvation. And so prior to 1967, when he did studies with Oliver Owen at Harvard, it was thought that the brain relied exclusively off glucose as its primary fuel source, that 100% of the energy from the brain was derived from glucose. And that is true in the fed state. So we know when our bodies are fed, especially with carbohydrates, that our brain activity is fed primarily 100% off glucose. But during a state of starvation, he had written a report showing in humans, actually, that during starvation, prolonged starvation, up to 2/3 of the energy from our brain is derived from ketone bodies. And beta-hydroxybutyrate is the primary ketone body, and acetoacetate. So I asked the question, like, how did they do this? How did they, because you would have to measure the blood going to the brain and the blood coming away and determine the level of glucose and ketones in there. And most importantly, you would have to fast patients for a very long period of time to be able to get this data. So I dug deeper and came across a very interesting body of literature. And this was a study that he had done at Harvard with Oliver Owen and other colleagues, where they fasted medical students, actually, for 40 days. And these were overweight medical students. Obviously, this is an experiment that could never be replicated today. So they essentially went without any food, without any calories, for 40 days, because it was in the Bible. So they fasted for 40 days, and that's a true story. And what they showed is that, you know, within a week's time, there was a dramatic elevation in the blood levels of ketones, and beta-hydroxybutyrate being the primary ketone body. And there was a quick drop in blood glucose that kind of stabilized, because our bodies are, the regulation of glucose is, there's very powerful homeostatic mechanisms that regulate the level of glucose in our blood. And we call, one word is gluconeogenesis, is the way. So we can break down amino acids and even break down products from fatty acids, glycerol, to maintain the level of glucose. But what was very clear from the studies that he did, and what, you know, was prior, you know, unknown, was that the primary energy substrate during prolonged fasting was ketone bodies. So as an extension of this study that is really remarkable and kind of fascinates me today, he provided evidence that ketosis protects the brain, provides resilience against hypoglycemia. Now what he did in a subsection of these subjects in a fasted state, he injected 20 IUs of insulin, was administered. Now, if you know, insulin is a very powerful drug, and if any of us were, you know, injected with 20 IUs of insulin and no carbohydrates, it would lead to hypoglycemia and death, likely, or into a coma. But what was interesting in these fasting subjects, you would think they would be even more reactive to the insulin injected. It produced severe hypoglycemia, 1 to 2 millimolars, which is usually fatal, 100% fatal, 1 millimolar would be, in subjects. So the severe hypoglycemia was achieved in these subjects, but all of them survived without brain damage and without coma. And interestingly, all three were asymptomatic for hypoglycemia. They were perfectly fine, so they had no signs of hypoglycemia. And it's really a dramatic demonstration that ketone bodies, elevated during starvation, can protect the brain or preserve brain metabolism during hypoglycemia. So the implications of that, when I read this, I thought the implications of that were tremendous. I thought, you know, there's a wide variety of applications for an alternative fuel to glucose for the brain. So before I go any farther, I want to cover briefly some ketone terminology. And I realize that there have been other speakers here that talked about the ketogenic diet and low-carb dieting, and they've covered the subject really well. And what I want to do is just kind of do a quick overview, because many of you people are familiar with this topic. Just to let you know that ketone bodies, one of the main messages here, are that they are energy substrates from fatty acid oxidation, typically. So your body takes fats from the food that we eat or from our body fat, and our liver can convert these to essentially water-soluble fat molecules that can cross the blood-brain barrier and become an efficient fuel source for the brain. Ketosis is defined somewhat arbitrarily as an elevation of blood ketones above 0.5 millimolar. So that'll become sort of important as I talk to you about some of the data that we have. Nutritional ketosis, achieved with typically the ketogenic diet, is a dietary strategy to elevate blood ketones primarily from the restriction of carbohydrates. So our diets are comprised of fats, protein, and carbohydrates. And the USDA guidelines indicate that we should get about 65, maybe 70% of our energy from carbohydrates. So restricting what is considered to be the primary source of energy in our diets is kind of difficult for us to do. So achieving nutritional ketosis to elevate ketones involves a highly motivated person that follows a pretty strict dietary guidelines. So when we talk about ketosis, what often comes up in my talks, the question is ketoacidosis. So I want to address this now. Most people, when they hear the word ketosis, they think of diabetic ketoacidosis. And that occurs, it's metabolic disorder or metabolic derangement, if you want to call it that, that occurs in type 1 diabetics who are deficient in insulin. So insulin plays a big role in regulating many aspects of metabolism, including ketogenesis. And without insulin in our body, we have essentially runaway ketogenesis. So we have very high elevation of ketones, and we have an high elevation of glucose at the same time. So this can lead to a pathological condition, a metabolic acidosis that can quickly lead to coma and death. So nutritional ketosis is much different than that. So the two are very different. With an elevation of pathological ketosis occurs typically when ketone levels get well above 10 millimolar and also when blood glucose levels are high. Whereas nutritional ketosis is achieved at just 1 millimolar, up to 5 millimolar typically, and blood glucose stays low. So that's an important message that I want you to have. Keto adaptation is a term that's used to describe the physiological shift towards using fatty acids and ketone bodies for fuel. And this is a process, and it typically takes upwards of to 2 to 3 to 4 weeks for your body to become efficiently adapted to using ketones for fuel. And the longer you stay in ketosis, the better your body can utilize and transport ketones, and the easier it is to follow, and the more benefits you derive from it. So a lot of my talk, or the second half of my talk, is going to talk about exogenous ketones. So these can be produced synthetically or from naturally derived substances that artificially produce what I call instant ketosis. So in the graph I showed you, it takes about a week to produce, really high levels of ketones in the blood. Well, what if we could do that in just 10 to 15 minutes? And I showed you that ketones are very neuroprotective, and they protect the brain against hypoglycemia, and they also provide the brain an efficient source of energy, which is critical, perhaps, in diseases where there's impaired glucose metabolism in the brain. So getting back to nutritional ketosis as it relates to the ketogenic diet, we know that the ketogenic diet, which is restricting carbohydrates and eating high fat, mimics the effect of fasting. And specifically, it mimics the effect of fasting in controlling seizures. So the ketogenic diet is the standard of care for drug refractory or drug resistant epilepsy. So when drugs fail, and this has been shown quite convincingly in the literature through a number of different studies, the ketogenic diet can control seizures in about 2/3 of the patients with drug refractory epilepsy. And one-third of those patients are completely seizure-free, up to 90% or more seizure-free. So it's remarkably effective as a means to metabolically manage seizures. And I think it's grossly underutilized, because usually it's the last resort, you know, that is given to the patient. But what's important, and perhaps a reason for that, is that compliance to the diet is very difficult to do for many people, especially for kids. So the diet needs to be highly restricted in carbohydrates, 5% or less, and very high, up to 75% of the energy of the diet needs to come from fats. So this macronutrient ratio needs to be maintained to elevate ketone levels in the body. And what typically happens with a ketogenic diet is that the fat from the diet and fat from body stores, reducing carbohydrates typically causes the body to release fatty acids from adipose tissue. So you have fat from your diet and fat from your fat stores being metabolized in the liver to produce these ketone bodies. So we have beta-hydroxybutyrate, acetoacetate, and acetone. That's not important to know that, but just to know that these are energy molecules. And they're energy molecules that are high-efficiency fuel for the brain, and we talked about it controlling seizures, but also for the heart. So work by Richard Veach at the NIH and his lab has shown that the hydraulic efficiency of the heart is produced, is increased dramatically, up to 25% to 30%, burning ketones relative to glucose. So we know that ketones, once thought of as a metabolic poison, are actually a very efficient molecule in far as energy currency in generating energy. And they're also used as energy for peripheral tissues. I won't be able to talk about it today, but we have some remarkable evidence that ketones can help with the wound healing process and also provide fuel for skeletal muscle. So as I mentioned, one of the avenues that we're exploring is the use of ketone supplementation to produce instant ketosis. So meaning a rapid and sustained elevation of blood ketones within 15 minutes. And we depending on the preparation, we can keep ketones elevated 2 to 8 hours with larger doses, even up to 12 hours. Ketone supplementation can come in a number of different forms. There are ketone esters that we've developed with the help of the Office of Navy Research, which are more potent, and there's esters of the two ketone bodies, beta-hydroxybutyrate and acetoacetate. You can take a ketone body and combine it with various minerals, including sodium, potassium, calcium, to create ketone mineral salts. And there's also on the market that you can buy naturally derived, I will say, ketogenic fats, and these include MCT, medium chain triglycerides. And these are sold, there's a number of brands that you can buy over the counter at most health food stores or online. And medium chain triglycerides are found primarily in coconut oil and also palm kernel oil. And there's, you know, MCTs are found in breast milk and goat's milk. They're part of the normal human nutrition. Actually, they're just found in very high concentrations in coconut oil and further refined so you can buy pure MCT oil. So the administration of these agents, well, I'll say the more potent ones, have a remarkable effect on blood glucose levels and ketone levels, including blood beta-hydroxybutyrate, urine acetoacetate, and acetone, which we can also measure with a breath acetone meter. So an acute administration results in a drop in blood glucose that's really remarkable. And it's above and beyond anything that we've seen, for example, with a drug like metformin. So we see a pretty sharp decrease, up to 10-20% of blood glucose, levels of blood glucose. And we see a quick elevation of the blood levels of ketones with a large dose. And the other ketone bodies are elevated too, acetoacetate and acetone. Now you need a fairly, it's not like a pill that you could take. So it's not the ketogenic diet in a pill per se. So you do need to take a relatively large dose of this. This is a calorie containing substance. And so you need to take it in relatively large forms. to elevate the levels in the blood. And you know, it's also a source of energy, so as you exercise and move around, your body will use this as fuel. And like glucose, the glucose levels will drop as you exercise, as will ketone bodies. So we wanted to use this strategy for CNS oxygen toxicity in our rodent model of CNS oxygen toxicity. And so our strategy was to give therapeutic ketosis with a ketone ester to determine if it delays CNS oxygen toxicity. And a single administration of the more potent ketone ester causes a rapid, you know, within 30 minutes, and sustained elevation of blood ketone levels above what is typically thought as the therapeutic range, and it's maintained over time. And what we've demonstrated, and we've tested a number of different agents, and this is an agent that elevates primarily beta-hydroxybutyrate, and this elevates both ketone bodies, beta-hydroxybutyrate and acetoacetate. We found that when we elevate both ketone bodies, we have a remarkable increase in the seizure resistance. So nearly a 600% increase in resistance. I told you that rats can withstand about 10 minutes of 5 atmospheres of oxygen, and most of our rats went beyond 50 to 60 minutes to an hour with no problems. So this is above and beyond anything that has been shown in the literature, either anticonvulsant drug or anti-seizure drug. So we were really encouraged that we're on the right path for preventing CNS oxygen toxicity. So we want to understand how this works. To understand, I know this is a pretty busy slide here, and I'm going to go through it fast, but mechanistically, the things that are circled here are the things that our lab is focusing on to understand mechanistically how these agents are working. And I just wanted to highlight a few things. Now, we've shown that we've looked at the blood, and we've also taken the brains out of the rodents, and we've demonstrated an elevation in the blood and in the brain tissue of the ketone bodies, but also an elevation in the GABA to glutamate ratio. So GABA prevents hyperexcitability in the brain, where glutamate causes excess hyperexcitability, or too much of it does. So by increasing the formation of GABA, which is actually made from glutamate, this tends to dampen and reduce the excitotoxic effects that oxygen can have. We've also observed that there's a 2 to 3-fold higher levels of what we call Krebs cycle or TCA cycle intermediates. So these are all the molecules that are kind of breakdown products in metabolism that are a clear indication that the brain has higher levels of energy reserve. So we can measure this in the blood and in the brain. And we see other things are that adenosine, carnosine, or anserin, these are antioxidants. So there's a variety of things going on here and not just one thing. And that's important because anti-epileptic drugs tend to target one pathway. But with a metabolic therapy, you have multiple pathways being activated, all working together. And that's an important aspect of the therapy. And it's doing it in a physiological, non-toxic way. I'm sure there's a toxicity level to the agents we're working with, but it's relatively high compared to drugs. And we also see a decrease in glucose, and a decrease in blood levels of insulin, and a decrease in oxidative stress, reactive oxygen species. And most importantly, the thing that we're very interested in is the elevation of brain energy reserves. Now, this is important because neurological disorders, pretty much all neurological disorders you can think of, are associated in one way or another with impaired brain energy or brain glucose metabolism. So to assess brain metabolism, we use a glucose scan or a fluorodeoxyglucose scan. It's a radio-labeled glucose molecule that the patient consumes, or the subject consumes, and we can determine regionally specific levels of glucose uptake. And this would be representative of a normal brain. And this would be representative of someone with mild to moderate Alzheimer's disease. So Alzheimer's disease is associated with impaired glucose metabolism in the brain. And And that results from a number of different things. The Alzheimer's pathology itself is an accumulation of toxic proteins, but also there's various enzymes that are dysregulated in Alzheimer's disease. But what could be significant is that ketones perhaps can restore brain metabolism when there's a defect in glucose metabolism. And we know with traumatic brain injury, with Parkinson's disease, with a number of metabolic disorders, even ALS, that there's impaired glucose transport. And that is really could be at the heart of the disorder. So the message that hopefully it got across to you are that is that the brain in particular, and all healthy cells in general, typically have, or most healthy cells have, metabolic flexibility. So like a hybrid engine, your brain can use glucose or use ketones for fuel. And as I transition now into another topic, cancer, one of the messages that I want to get across, and it's kind of it's a characteristic that is kind of the backbone of the therapies we're working on, is that cancer cells lack this metabolic flexibility. They lack the metabolic flexibility from using glucose as a primary energy source to using ketones or fatty acids. So cancer has very high rates of glucose metabolism. In some cells, in using a PET scan, you can show up to 200 times the rate of glucose metabolism. There's an increase in glucose transporters. There's an increase in insulin receptors. So there's a number of reasons for that. And it's also the underlying reason why we can image cancer. So the gold standard for imaging the location and the aggressiveness of cancer would be a glucose or a fluorodeoxyglucose PET scan. And in this example here, this is a subject with advanced metastatic cancer. You can see the areas lighting up in the lung and in the liver and in the bone. And this is indicating that the cancer cells are outcompeting the healthy cells for glucose. So we call this the Warburg effect. And this was named, this metabolic characteristic of cancer cells was named by Otto Warburg, or named from the work that Otto Warburg did. And he received a Nobel Prize in 1931 for his work in metabolism. That effectively showed that cancer was a disease of metabolic origin. And he was really the first to describe cancer as a metabolic disease. So, and what his research was showing is that a metabolic defect within cancer cells, specifically the mitochondria, forced cancer cells to not be able to derive energy from fatty acids and ketones, but force the cancer cells to derive energy specifically from glycolysis. So knowing this, we can move forward to develop therapies. And there's a wide body of literature to support the work that Warburg did. And we know from previous studies that high glucose and low oxygen within the tumor can drive what we call the Warburg effect. The Warburg effect is essentially fermentation. You're fermenting sugar to produce energy, and that also produces lactate. And it's a very inefficient form of energy, but the Warburg effect can confer kind of an advantage to cancer cells because it allows cancer cells to evade low levels of oxygen. As a tumor grows, it lacks the ability to get sufficient amount of oxygen to the area because the blood supply can't keep up. So as cancer cells become more adept at using glucose, this is the Warburg effect. They can thrive in the low oxygen environment. So, and that's going to be important as I show you kind of data later on. But what has been established is that high glycemic diets can increase the risk of cancer, that hyperglycemia is associated with a poor prognosis if you have cancer. Unregulated blood glucose can lead to a poor prognosis. And we know from a number of studies that blood glucose is correlated with tumor growth. And here's an example here We have tumor growth here and glucose on the x-axis. As glucose levels increase, you get a proportional rise in tumor growth. And I think this is very important information with someone that has cancer. So you want to get glucose levels as low as possible to suppress the growth of cancer. So we know the ketogenic diet limits carbohydrates, which is effectively limiting glucose availability to the tumor cells. And to do this, as mentioned, your diet has to be very, very high in fat and restricted in carbohydrates to induce a state of ketosis. And this also suppresses the hormone insulin. So we know insulin essentially drives every pathway associated with cancer growth and proliferation. And it's that low level of insulin that is suppressed that causes the liver to produce ketones. So really, it revolves around the suppression of insulin to drive hepatic ketogenesis. So this is a very, insulin, there's a number of signaling molecules like insulin-like growth factor and other things that are downstream signals of insulin. And a number of growth factors that the pharmaceutical industry is aggressively trying to target are suppressed dramatically just by lowering insulin with diet. And also, as a tumor grows, this is an example of normal vasculature or normal blood supply. As a tumor grows, the blood supply becomes erratic, and you get essentially tumor hypoxia. And to evade hypoxia, the cancer cells kick on a number of genes we call oncogenes that allow the cancer cells to take up more sugar and to survive in this low oxygen environment. And it's the low oxygen environment that causes resistance against chemotherapy and radiation. So as it relates to radiation therapy, we know that the efficacy of radiation therapy is proportional to the PO2 in the tumor. So if the oxygen level is low and a tumor is radiated, it's going to have very little effect. If the oxygen level is high and you apply radiation, you create a lot of free radicals, which can then kill the tumor. So it becomes a roadblock for the efficacy of radiation. So oxygen in general, though, we found in early studies that oxygen is toxic to cancer cells, that high pressure of oxygen damages cancer cells. And we developed some of the technologies that I showed you earlier. After we developed them, we started testing, what happens to all these different cells if we give them oxygen. So I would get, muscle cells and healthy brain cells and brain tumor cells. And we started looking at a variety of different cell types and exposing them to hyperbaric oxygen. And what we observed, kind of in a nutshell, is that the level of oxygen that was relatively non-toxic to healthy brain cells was toxic to brain cancer cells. And we were able to show this over and over. And essentially what was happening is that the brain cancer cells were overproducing oxygen-free radicals. And this was causing damage to the cell membrane. We call membrane lipid peroxidation. And with the techniques that we had in the lab installed inside the microscopes installed inside the chamber, we were able to visualize the physical correlate of membrane lipid peroxidation, to visualize cancer cells dying or the events that occur just preceding the death of the cancer cells. So I was not a cancer scientist at the time, but these observations motivated us to test a metabolic therapy and test the effects of hyperbaric oxygen in a whole animal model. So around that time, we started some experiments also putting ketones directly onto cancer cells in a petri dish. And what we observed is that in cells given no ketones at all, there was very little cell death. But in brain cancer cells that were given a physiological level of ketones, we saw an increase in the amount of dead cancer cells. And we also saw the green staining here is the live cells, which we measure proliferation rates. And we've demonstrated that in the presence of ketones, physiological levels of ketones, that we were able to reduce cancer cell proliferation. Now, what I thought was really remarkable with these studies is that this was observed even in the presence of high glucose levels. So in the media, we didn't change the level of glucose. So independent of the glucose levels, ketones had an effect at suppressing cancer growth and increasing the death of cancer cells. And we recently published that. Up until recently, I thought I was the only investigator studying this phenomenon, the effects of metabolic therapies, or ketones specifically, on cancer, exogenous ketones. But just recently, within a week or two ago, came across a very elegant study out of Nebraska that showed metabolic reprogramming induced by ketone bodies diminished pancreatic cancer cachexia. Cachexia is a word for muscle wasting. And if you've known people with advanced cancer, muscle wasting is part of that and usually leads to their demise, the rapid wasting of skeletal muscle. So in a nutshell, I just want to cover some of the main findings of the study. They demonstrated, as we have, but they actually tested beta-hydroxybutyrate and acetoacetate, showed that it inhibited cancer growth in this pancreatic cancer model, and that the ketones increase cancer cell death, which we have shown, and that it suppressed the oncogenic growth signals, like c-MYC. Now, this is a very hot target for pharmaceuticals targeting this growth pathway. So you have something that your body produces endogenously that we can exploit if we further elevate the levels that can inhibit this pathway in a non-toxic way. And they also found that ketones reduced the growth of cancer and prevents cancer cachexia. So we know that one function of ketones during starvation, a major function, is that they prevent the body from wasting away. So if we go weeks without eating, the ketones can replace glucose as a primary energy source. And if ketones were not an energy source, we would be breaking down a lot of our skeletal muscle and proteins, you know, in our organs to feed our bodies. But the ketones can prevent, they have a protein sparing effect, we say. So now this leads us to our cancer research, and I'm going to focus on specifically the question, can nutritional ketosis achieved with a diet or ketone supplementation combined with hyperbaric oxygen prolong survival from metastatic cancer? So most people who die of cancer, they don't die of a tumor, they die of metastatic cancer spreading to different areas of the body. And interestingly, cancer researchers typically rarely study metastatic cancer. They study a tumor implanted underneath the skin, and they look at the growth of the tumor or the shrinking. So we think it's important to study a process that's mostly involved with advanced cancer. And this was actually the PhD project of my student, who's now Dr. Angela Poff. So what I'll be covering today was part of her studies that I thought had the most practical application for all of you here. And essentially, is kind of, you get the idea, is that the therapies were designed to lower blood glucose and suppress insulin, and also to elevate ketones and oxygen levels. So the idea here is to create metabolic stress within the cancer cells. So we know cancer cells are selectively vulnerable to low glucose and insulin and high ketones, and if we reverse tumor hypoxia by saturating the tumor with oxygen, we can actually kick off oncogenes and reverse some of this Warburg effect that I was talking about. So the model that we chose to use was the VM model of metastatic cancer. And this was developed by Dr. Thomas Seyfried at Boston College, and it actually made the cover of the International Journal of Cancer. And it shares many of the similarities to the most aggressive human metastatic cancers. Injecting a small volume of cells underneath the skin causes rapid metastasis to many organs of the body, and even you could see a little bit of bioluminescence in the brain here. So the cancer cells glow specifically because the tumor cells have the gene for fireflies. If you've seen them, fireflies, they glow naturally through the production of luciferase. And the cancer cells have been transfected in a way to express this. So it allows us to track tumor growth over time as we assess the efficacy of our metabolic therapies. And most importantly in our model system here is that the the animals are immunocompetent. In many cancer studies, there are the mice are without an immune system. And even chemotherapy can wipe out your immune system. So we think the immune system is very important for someone to be able to recover from cancer, and we wanted to use a model that was immunocompetent. So in this model, you have rapid systemic metastasis that goes to all the organs. Here's an example of the liver, and the liver is essentially peppered with tumors. So it's a very, very aggressive cancer model. And there's a number of models where people have cured cancer, but this model remains uncured. So I wanted to take a shot with our therapies at this model for that reason, because it's so aggressive. And so the methods that we tested that I'm going to share with you tonight, there's a number of things that we're testing, but the treatment groups, the control group would be the standard high carbohydrate diet. The treatment groups would be the ketogenic diet, ketone ester supplementation to mimic the effects of the ketogenic diet, and hyperbaric oxygen therapy. And these things were used alone and in combination. And here is the hyperbaric oxygen chamber that we use for our rodent studies. And we can typically put in about, you know, 6 to 10 mice in here, and they actually respond very well to hyperbaric oxygen therapy. It tends to wake them up, and overall they increase their activity in response to high levels of oxygen. So here is an example of ketosis achieved through diet and through supplementation combined with hyperbaric oxygen, showing that it dramatically slows metastatic cancer and extends survival. And these mice were implanted with tumor cells 3 weeks ago, 21 days. So here is an example of a mouse that is eating a standard high carbohydrate diet. This is a mouse that has been eating the ketogenic diet, and we combine the ketogenic diet with ketone supplementation, and we also combine the ketogenic diet and supplementation with hyperbaric oxygen. And here's a graph showing the effects of tumor growth. So we track the bioluminescent signal is an index of the tumor growth here. And here you can see the combination therapy of the diet with supplementation and hyperbaric oxygen cause the greatest suppression of tumor growth over time. And here's an example of the survival curve. The black line here would be the survival curve of animals that were eating a high carbohydrate standard diet. And I just want to draw your attention to the combination therapy, where the ketogenic diet and ketone esters with hyperbaric oxygen were utilized. And this is a very significant extension of life in this particular animal model. There's been a study done with chemotherapeutic agents, methotrexate and cisplatin, and the best that was achieved is somewhere around here. So these are results above and beyond what has been achieved or published with chemotherapy. So we saw an extension of survival time over 100% with this combination therapy. So the important question for you tonight, I think, and the message I want to convey is, how can we implement this metabolic therapy? Now, there's a lot of convincing data out there that the ketogenic diet, calorie restriction, fasting, and even hyperbaric oxygen have anti-cancer effects. But if you bring this up to your doctor, they're not going to support. Even if you failed the standard of care and have no other options, they will probably talk you out of trying a ketogenic diet, a low-carbohydrate diet, or hyperbaric oxygen therapy, unless you've had radiation. So someone who has radiation necrosis, hyperbaric oxygen therapy is used to treat the wounds. So that is important to know as I kind of cover some of the guidelines for implementing this. So it's really important for patients to be monitored by their own physician, and there are a number of physicians out there that are open-minded that will look over the literature and the science and support or at least monitor patients during this process. And it's really important, especially initially, to work closely with a registered dietitian that's kind of knowledgeable or savvy with the ketogenic diet. Now, I have a pretty tight relationship with the Charlie Foundation and have, you know, spoken on their behalf. And I can say the Charlie Foundation has been around for decades now, And they have hundreds of dietitians that are trained to put children on a ketogenic diet for drug refractory epilepsy. And now they get more calls and more requests for cancer patients than they do for epilepsy patients now. So my understanding is that they are giving advice and information and consulting to cancer patients. And I'd like to bring the attention to books, and I help the authors of the books. One is Fight Cancer with a Ketogenic Diet, and another, The Ketogenic Diet for Cancer. So the guidelines in these books are very good and something that I recommend if you're seeking information about these therapies. So just real simple, and kind of already covered this, the standard diet versus the ketogenic diet, there's a lot of confusion here because many people think a ketogenic diet is a high protein diet, but it's really not. And we know that it's a low carbohydrate diet, but a ketogenic diet is really not a high protein diet, it's a high fat diet. And that scares a lot of people because there's kind of a fear of fat among medical practitioners and the government in general. It's important to know that it is high fat and you'll need to radically alter your diet if it's not. And there are a number of challenges to initiating this kind of diet, mainly due to compliance. So if you have liver cancer, I talked about the liver is a source of ketones. Your liver makes ketones and your peripheral tissues uses it. So interestingly, the liver cannot use ketones due to deficiency in some enzymes. And one is succinyl-CoA transferase. It's an enzyme that's critical for cells to be able to make energy from ketones. And this enzyme is actually deficient in cancer cells. So the liver makes ketones, but it lacks the ability to use them for fuel. It can use amino acids and other things. So liver cancer is a problem if you want to embark on a ketogenic diet because it may impair your liver's ability to make ketones. Kidney stones and renal disease could be a challenge to initiate the ketogenic diet. People with pancreatitis usually have a difficult time tolerating a high-fat diet. They can. There's people with fat malabsorption issues. Gallbladder obstruction or removal can be problematic. Although I've talked to a number of people that I know quite well that have had their gallbladders removed and that have no problem with a ketogenic diet at all. So you might need more of a transition to the diet over time. There's a wide variety of medications. Corticosteroids, for example, dexamethasone and prednisone will quickly, rapidly, and dramatically elevate blood glucose levels and make it hard to get into that state of nutritional ketosis. And one area that's really important, I should probably have a star here, is just lack of support. So you really need support from your doctor, from your family, from your friends, because it takes a lot of motivation. The patient needs to be highly motivated to really embark in this therapy. And if you don't clear the house out of foods that would could allow you to break ketosis, this is going to be hard to do, I can tell you that. Even someone who goes at doing this, you know, in a very motivated way, it can be difficult. And you really, the people in your household need to understand that your diet is very special in a way and that they shouldn't be offering you food that can break ketosis. So it's really important and it should be a star there. Support for this is absolutely essential. And there's some concern over high cholesterol levels. I think the jury's still out on kind of the implications of that and whether that should be a concern. But for some people, the LDL cholesterol, considered the bad cholesterol, can rapidly go up and significantly in some people. The implications of that are really not known. Other biomarkers of metabolic health typically improve in nutritional ketosis. Food selection could be a challenge. For me, I like eating high-fat foods. High-fat foods taste good, so that's a pro to me. And then weight loss, too. I mean, weight loss is Generally, I think I read about 70% of cancer patients that get diagnosed or more are overweight. So weight loss could be a good thing, because if you bring your weight down, usually your metabolic biomarkers will improve. But if you have advanced cancer or cachexia, weight loss can be a real problem. So you don't want to restrict calories too much. So people who follow the ketogenic diet sometimes inadvertently reduce calories just because ketones have a satiating effect on your appetite. So the idea here behind the metabolic management of cancer is that you want to achieve essentially this. You want to use an aggressive metabolic approach that lowers glucose and elevates ketones to an area that we call the metabolic zone, and which has been effectively shown in animal models and in a case report here, even in a glioblastoma, patient with glioblastoma, to effectively manage the growth and proliferation of cancer. So this is essentially the goal here. Achieving this is very difficult to do. It's going to take a team, family and friends support, a motivated patient, and a good nutritionist to tweak the diet to get to this. But essentially, yeah, you want a ketone levels up to 3.6 would be needed, and glucose levels down to 70, and to sustain that in a daily basis, to sustain that. And in this physiological state, it really compromises the growth of cancer. And it also makes cancer vulnerable to any modality you put on top of that, which is could be the standard of care. It could be chemo, radiation, or hyperbaric oxygen. So it weakens the cancer and makes it more vulnerable to other modalities. So, and there's a number of case reports out there, and I have people kind of email me, or their doctors email me, or in this case, the patients of a, or the parents rather, of a 10-year-old male who was diagnosed with an ependymoma in 2009, had 9 surgeries, 2 radiotherapy courses. The tumors were resistant to treatment. These are very resilient tumors. You treat them and they just come back. And he started hyperbaric oxygen and a carbohydrate restricted diet in February 2014. And this was his scans in February 2014. The right parietal lesion here, there's a lot of edema and hydrocephalus associated with the tumor. And here's the midline section of the tumors. And this is after 5 months of treatment with 100 sessions of hyperbaric oxygen with diet therapy. Now, the parents found it very hard to maintain their son in nutritional ketosis, but they eliminated, to the best of their degree, any kind of sugar in his diet and most forms of starch and carbohydrate, and was able to get a pretty remarkable response with this kind of tumor, a shrinking, which is resistant to most forms of standard care. This is a pretty remarkable response with something that's, and this is after being treated with the standard of care. So this is something that's non-toxic and is not harming the patient in any way. And I think neurologically too, the child is doing much better than before. So if this is so effective, where's all the human trials? You know, where's the evidence for this? And there's been 2 or 3 clinical trials, we call them pilot studies, that have been done with a ketogenic diet. And it's only really approved by the IRB if all other therapies have failed. That's the only way you're really going to get acceptance to use this strategy for cancer patients. And that was a case in this study here where 16 patients with advanced cancer were put on the ketogenic diet. And essentially what they showed was that the diet was very safe, there was very little, if any, side effects, and that the patients had generally reported a better quality of life while being in ketosis. And another study by Eugene Fine and colleagues, this study involved 10 advanced cancer patients. I think there was ovarian cancer and you know, a wide variety of actually different cancers. And in these patients, there was 10 patients, they responded very well to the ketogenic diet, and their outcomes correlated with the level of ketones in their body, so which also inversely related to insulin levels. So the lower the insulin and the higher the ketones, the better they did. So I want to bring to your attention, it's very encouraging to me that There are, if you search on the government website, clinicaltrials.gov, and search ketogenic diet and cancer, there's 13 studies now in progress that just sort of came out in the last 2 to 3 years. So I think some of our research has been getting publicity, and some of my colleagues, Thomas Seyfried and Adrian Scheck at Barrow Neurological Institute, are doing some great work here. And it's motivating these clinical trials. So what's important in these clinical trials is that they get patients into that physiological metabolic zone. So in summary here, just to cover the potential therapeutic implications, nutritional ketosis achieved through diet or supplementation mimics the metabolic state of fasting and decreases the potential for seizures from a wide variety of seizures. It's non-toxic, cost-effective, readily implementable, possibly effective against aggressive late-stage cancers. The ketogenic diet and hyperbaric oxygen may have potential synergy with the standard of care. And we also think that, you know, you've probably heard of the phenomenon of chemo brain. Chemotherapy and radiation are very damaging to the brain. And we think that the ketogenic diet may be a neuroprotective strategy if someone is undergoing radiation or cancer treatment, radiation treatment. So in further directions, we are determined to find the best method to achieve the metabolic zone. We want to figure out specifically what's the optimal dose range for hyperbaric oxygen. I want to evaluate this therapy in other models of cancer. We know that if the cancer is hot on a PET scan, it's showing the Warburg effect, and it should be, in theory, highly responsive to this metabolic therapy. We want to explore, I didn't get to talk about it today, but explore non-toxic metabolic drugs like metformin, like dichloroacetate or DCA. There's a variety of things out there we're testing now, and these things seem to be effective in high doses, and we think will work remarkably well with other things we're doing. And also phytonutrient cocktails, green tea, turmeric, there's a lot of things out there that we want to test. And the idea is to get these things, the effective things, into clinical trials. So I want to thank you for your attention. If there's any questions you have, I would be glad to answer them. And I want to acknowledge the Office of Navy Research again and the company Scivation. They've been kind enough to give us a donation to cover much of the cancer research that I showed you. And everybody in the lab here, this couldn't happen without, you know, a great lab and students and postdoctoral fellows that are really driving the research in the lab. Thank you very much for your attention. Here are resources too, or websites to direct you to some of the things that I was talking about today. So if anyone has any questions, I'd be glad to answer them. Yes. Right. Yes.
Hi, I'm curious why they use 100% oxygen in their diving instead of compressed air?
Yeah, that's a really good question. So the Navy SEALs use equipment called a closed circuit rebreather, and it's relatively small to the gas tanks that is used for recreational diving. The advantage of a closed circuit rebreather, there are no bubbles coming up. So there's a stealth component to this. So you can evade detection. You swim usually at under shallow depths, and if you're especially like in the jungle or something like that, it essentially allows them to sneak up on people and get the mission done in a very stealth way. So the advantage is that it's very quiet, so you can evade detection. You also avert decompression sickness, because decompression sickness results from excess nitrogen, and with 100% oxygen, you won't have that problem. But the disadvantage, and it's a major one, is that oxygen toxicity, if they're extended, if they have to dive down low to put a mine on a ship, and there's been reports of guys getting hit. Yes?
Well, I wonder if there's any, people are sitting here who are perfectly healthy, who are going to say, wow, maybe I better start doing this. So I can stave these things off. Do you have any data like that?
Yeah, and actually during my talk, I didn't put a slide up on prevention. And I think, you know, screening and prevention are first and foremost the most important things, you know, to stave off cancer. But it's my opinion that if someone were to do a therapeutic fast, perhaps for 3 days, maybe a week, or if they can tolerate it, 10 days, we all probably, not to freak people out, but we all probably have cancer in our bodies or precancerous cells, but our immune system keeps that in check. You know, one way to purge our bodies of precancerous cells or maybe even existing cancer cells is to do a water-only fast for up to 7 days. And that puts our body into a very radical metabolic state with low blood glucose, very low insulin levels, and high ketones. And if we were to do that once, maybe twice a year, I believe that that could be an effective way to prevent. If you look at different cultures that do fasting, you know, there are lower rates of cancer. So my, you know, the ones that I love, the people like my parents and their friends and other people, they're not very motivated to do it, but it's my belief that that could be a low carbohydrate diet, actually a ketogenic diet for one thing, but also do periodic fasting. And it may not be a good idea to stay in ketosis all the time, probably to bounce in and out of ketosis, but I think a carbohydrate restricted diet is definitely very safe. And I think in the long run, managing insulin and managing glucose in the long run is going to play a big role in our long-term health and preventing the early onset of age-related chronic illnesses like diabetes and Alzheimer's and cancer even.
We have time for one more question.
Yes, the gentleman over there.
Carbohydrates are relatively new to mankind. In early men, they just existed on fat and protein.
Yeah.
Is all this cancer we're seeing in our society now a result of all the carbohydrates that we're now eating, the breads, the fries, that are only there because they help sustain huge, vast quantities of people? Is that just a whole symptom of our what we've chosen to make our food?
That's a pretty hot topic and pretty... You know, I don't have an answer, but I think it contributes to it. Anything that, from my perspective, anything that pushes metabolic health in the negative direction, by I mean like elevation of C-reactive protein, of high glucose levels, high insulin, will spark, you know, the development of cancers that probably would otherwise be managed if the person was on a low carbohydrate diet, did, you know, lots of exercise instead of our sedentary world, we tend not to exercise as much. And maybe the macronutrient kind of profile of our food is really important, but also the macronutrient sources are important. You know, maybe buying grass-fed beef or making an effort to pick, you know, food sources that are of higher quality too. But I think that's important, but I really think the macronutrient ratio is probably more important. But, you know, that's a good question. I think it also comes down to the overconsumption. So we get in a lot of surplus calories over time, and that can contribute to, you know, metabolic syndrome, which can exacerbate other disorders and contribute to the early onset of age-related.
Just to follow up.
Yeah, this is kind of debated too. I don't think so, but I think they went in and out of ketosis a lot. I think their protein was probably high enough to prevent them from being in strong ketosis, but I think food availability, depending on your geographical location, was limited at certain periods. So it's you know, it's highly likely that they were bouncing in and out of ketosis depending on seasonal availability of food and their geographical location if they're at a more northern climate. Of course, like the Inuits, you know, were basically a carbohydrate-free diet for a long time, and their incidence of heart disease and cancer were, you know, like little or none. So, and that's a population eating, you know, a high-fat diet.
So with that, let's thank our speaker.
Thank you.